Welcome to study session 4, Essentials of Counseling Practicum. In the previous study session, you were introduced to the motivation for counseling as well as the needs for counseling. In this study session, you will be introduced to the essentials of counseling practicum as well as the basic principles of guidance and counseling. Learning outcomes from study session 4. At the end of this study session, you should be able to explain the essentials of counseling practicum, highlight the basic principles of guidance and counseling. Essentials of counseling practicum. The counseling practicum is usually regarded as a learning experience with growth potential, where the student learns about his strengths and weaknesses in his counseling skills. He has the opportunity to correct himself when mistakes are made before his practice as a professional. The student counselor should know what the practicum supervisor expects from him, such as gaining counseling experience. Acquiring counseling experience is very essential in practicum. The student counselor should strive to develop the necessary skills or traits required of a professional counselor. He should be in constant touch with the practicum supervisor whenever any ambiguity or any other problem arises during practicum experience. He can be assisted during practicum to perfect the counseling skills acquired during his preparation. Ability to acquire counseling skills. Ability to develop, test, or practicalize the counseling skills acquired during training. The student counselor develops his counseling skills when he explores and understands the experience of the client from a theoretical background. Test his counseling skills when interviews alternative lines of action with the clients, making use of the background information collected while developing skills. He practicalizes his skills when he makes use of his overall training to the effective counseling of the client, or when he makes use of information resulting from his explorations in the diagnosis of adjustment problems. Knowledge of counseling techniques. The counseling techniques and other processes of the disposal of the counselor or student counselor vary from confronting the client when discrepancy arises, in his expression to other processes such as expression of feelings, role-playing, attending, interpreting, and clarifying. There are also many counseling techniques which the student counselor can utilize during the practicum. As the student counselor would have been exposed to different counseling strategies, some students are usually confronted or confused with the choice of which counseling theory to use. Some try to approach every problem from one particular counseling perspective, while others use different counseling theories for different problems. This is to say that one can be exclusively psychoanalytic, client-centered, or rational emotive in approach, or one may let the nature of the problem dictate the counseling theory or approach to be utilized. Whichever counseling theory or approach is preferred, the student counselor should be aware of the following: creating a free and relaxing atmosphere for the client throughout the counseling session is an essential ingredient for success. Sitting the client in a position where he or she will not be easily distracted, paying attention and listening to the content and observing the non-verbal aspects of the client's expression, expressing adequately the feelings of the client at the appropriate time during the counseling session. Knowledge of appropriate feeling words can be useful here. Making use of appropriate counseling leads whenever and wherever appropriate during the counseling session. Allowing the client to fully express himself and not to turn the counseling session into a mini lecture or question and answer interaction. Getting the client involved in the discussion and any step formulated, thus enabling him to grow, as well as planning a program of change, encourage the implementation of the program and following up on the planned program. From his interactions with the clients, from the feedback and the counseling techniques utilized, and from the follow-up on the clients, the student counselor can become aware of the counseling techniques which are viable for him or more useful than others. Hasty conclusions should not be drawn as for the effectiveness of the technique with subsequent clients. There is the opportunity to improve on those skills and processes as the student counselor becomes more knowledgeable and more competent in handling various cases. Basic principles of guidance and counseling. The basic principles of guidance and counseling, as accepted by most experts in the field of guidance and counseling, are explained as follows. Guidance and counseling is for everybody. The service of is not only for those with special handicaps, but it is also meant for all normal developing children and adults. The purposes of counseling should be based on clients' needs and not on the needs of the counselors. Guidance and counseling activities should therefore be based on the need and total development of every person. The functions of the guidance and is to help a person formulate and assess stimulating, worthwhile and attainable goals of behavior. Apply the goals to conduct his behavior. To administer guidance intelligently and with as thorough knowledge of the individual as is possible. Programs of the individual evaluation should be conducted and accurate. Consultative records of progress should be made accessible to guidance workers. Guidance and counseling is a sequential, continuous and developmental process which starts from birth to death. This means that guidance and counseling runs from the nursery school through primary, secondary to the tertiary institutions. It is not a once and for all event, but a process which is an integral part of the total educational program throughout the school life of an individual. This also guarantees that counselors will not use techniques and or approaches for which they do not have competence. All guidance activities must emphasize the will for each student to learn more about himself in an accurate and systematic manner through the use of well-planned instructional strategies and appraisal techniques. Individuals can become more knowledgeable about themselves and about the world around them. Without such knowledge, an individual cannot exercise intelligently the right to free choice in educational, vocational, and personal social fields. Guidance and counseling must be provided in a way that ensures human dignity and worth. The full and adequate development of the individual must be given preference. It should be seen as encouraging individuals to attain maximum satisfaction, to realize their potentials, and to be aware to self. No one who has gone through counseling should feel inadequate. Summary for study session 4. The counseling practicum is usually regarded as a learning experience with growth potential, where the student learns about his strengths and weaknesses in his counseling skills. He has the opportunity to correct himself when mistakes are made before his practice as a professional. The student counselor should know the practicum supervisor expects from him, such as gaining counseling experience, ability to acquire counseling skills, knowledge of counseling techniques, the basic principles of guidance and counseling as accepted by most experts in the field of guidance and counseling are explained as follows. Guidance and counseling is for everybody. The service is not only for those with special handicaps, but it is also meant for all normal developing children and adults. The purposes of counseling should be based on client's needs and not on the needs of the counselors. Guidance and counseling activities should therefore be based on the need and total development of every person. The functions of the guidance and is to help a person formulate and accept stimulating, worthwhile and attainable goals of behavior. Apply the goals to conduct his behavior, to administer guidance intelligently and with as thorough knowledge of the individual as is possible. Programs of individual evaluation should be conducted and accurate consultative records of progress should be made accessible to guidance workers. We have come to the end of study session 4. Thanks for listening.